On the planet of Motherworld, the royal bloodline reigned for centuries, but their greed for power led them to exhaust all available resources. Desperate for more, they unleashed their armies into space, conquering everything in their path. Then, a traitorous assassin struck down the king and queen, causing chaos on Motherworld. The conquered planets wanted to use that chance to start a revolution. Seizing the opportunity, Senator Belisarius took control and declared himself the regent. He dispatched his most brutal commander to crush all rebels without mercy. On a planet called Velt, Cora and Sam are working in the fields when they see a massive spaceship appear in the sky. Cora recognizes it as an Empire ship and immediately runs to ring the bell to alert everyone. Village leader Sindri gathers everyone to discuss how to approach the uninvited visitors. Farmer Gunner thinks it's a good opportunity and suggests they sell their grains to them for a good price. But Cora disagrees, pointing out that their mission here is destruction and enslavement. Sindri then decides they will offer nothing. Just then, three smaller ships land in the village. Admiral Noble approaches Sindri and explains that they are hunting a group of rebels led by Devra Bloodaxe and her brother Darien. However, his soldiers need food and offer to buy their grain at triple the market price. Sindri lies to the admiral, claiming that the village has barely enough for their own people, as the land is barren and they just had a harsh winter. Noble does not believe him and asks who oversees the harvest. Gunner speaks up and reveals that they actually do have surplus grain. Noble becomes angry at Sindri for lying. He grabs his cane and beats Sindri to death in front of his people. Sindri's wife is also killed by a soldier before she can reach him. Noble then declares that he will come back to collect all their grain in 10 weeks. Noble departs with his ships, leaving behind a small group of his soldiers to keep an eye on the village. The commander orders his subordinates to evict the residents from the house he wants to use. Private Eris opens a crate and finds Robot Jimmy, a mechanical soldier used to protect the king. Marcus mentions that after the king's death, they laid down their weapons and refused to fight. He even shoots at the robot to prove his point that no matter what he does, he won't fight back. Aris tries to defend the robot, but almost gets killed. The commander intervenes and stops them, then instructs Jimmy to wash off the dirt. Jimmy goes to the river to wash his face. Sam offers him a towel and sits down beside him. Jimmy mentions that Sam reminds him of Princess Issa, who was prophesied to bring a new era of peace and compassion, ending all wars, but was killed along with her parents during her coronation. He says that all the compassion and kindness died with her. Sam reassures him that it still lives in him and presents him with a flower wreath, causing him to blush. Meanwhile, the villagers gather to discuss what to do next. Den suggests that they should provide the crops to prove their worth, so they wouldn't be able to kill them. After hearing this, Cora rushes home to pack her belongings to leave. Hagen tries to stop her, reminding her that when he saved her from the wreckage of the ship and brought her back 2 years ago, this became her home. He believes it's time for her to unite all the rebels and protect the village. However, Cora refuses, believing they don't stand a chance. The soldiers grab Sam and intend to assault her. Cora hears her calling for help, but hesitates on whether she should intervene. Aris steps forward to stop them, but a fight breaks out, and he is overwhelmed by the group and subdued. Cora shows up with an axe, and the commander orders his soldiers to apprehend her. As they move to take away her axe, Cora suddenly attacks, incapacitating two soldiers in a few moves and seizing a gun to shoot at the others approaching her. She then engages in combat with the remaining soldiers, using her exceptional fighting skills to take down several of them. Eris also assists her in eliminating one soldier. She continues to fight until all the soldiers are killed, leaving only the commander who is holding Sam at gunpoint, threatening them to surrender their weapons. Just then, Jimmy enters. The commander orders him to kill them, but Jimmy picks up the gun and shoots the commander instead before running away. The villagers arrive and realize they must now fight. The next morning, Cora prepares to set out, and Hagen returns her weapon. She hopes to find the legendary General Titus to help them, as he once led his forces against the Motherworld. She asks Gunner to take her to the contact through whom he sold grain to the Bloodaxe rebels. That evening they stop to rest, and Cora confides her past as a soldier fighting for the king. When she was 9 years old, her home planet was attacked by the forces of Motherworld, led by Belisarius. Her people bravely fought back, but it only made Belisarius more brutal, slaughtering everyone. Cora had an opportunity to kill him when confronted, but her weapon was out of ammunition. Instead of killing her, Belisarius took her under his wing, giving her the name Arthelais and training her to become part of his troops. He considered her as his daughter and was proud that, at the age of 18, she became a commander and led forces to conquer other planets in the same way that Belisarius had murdered her family. So, she knows they will destroy the village. The next day, the duo arrives in the city, only to discover that Gunnar's contact has been captured. They decide to enter a tavern where a diverse group of patrons gathers. An alien offers to buy Gunnar from Cora, showing interest in him. When Cora tells him to back off, he becomes angry and threatens them with a knife. Cora easily disarms him and pins his head against the table. After he flees, Cora announces that she is looking for Titus. A man named Kai begins to pay attention, and a creature controls a human as a medium to speak to Cora, stating that Titus is living on a planet called Pollux. As they are about to leave, the alien returns with three accomplices seeking revenge, and a shootout erupts. Cora eliminates them, one by one. When the alien attacks Gunnar, she swiftly takes him down with a leg sweep and shoots the last accomplice. Just as the alien attempts to shoot Cora from behind, Kai raises his weapon and shoots him in the head. Kai offers to take them to Pollux in his ship for whatever they can pay, even after Cora mentions that they are seeking soldiers to fight against the Motherworld. Soon the ship takes off, and Kai suggests making a stop at another planet first, where they might find a warrior who could assist them in their rebellion. After a while, they arrive at a planet called New Wodi and find Tarek, who agrees to fight against the Motherworld, but is currently enslaved to repay his huge debts to the rancher, Hickman. After negotiations, Hickman proposes a bet. If Tarek can tame the creature called Bennu, he will be set free. Otherwise, all of them will become his slaves. Tarek approaches the Bennu and asks to release her. He then kneels to show he poses no threat and begins to talk to her. The Bennu calms down and accepts his touch. Tarek jumps on her back, causing her to become agitated and take flight. Several times, she attempts to shake off Tarek by crashing into the rocks. Tarek is knocked off, but as the Bennu takes flight once more, Tarek makes a run and jumps from the cliff, successfully landing on her back. This time, the Bennu is finally tamed and soars through the sky. After they return, Hickman keeps his word and sets Tarek free. As the group leaves, Hickman eagerly attempts to ride the Bennu, but is clawed to death. Afterward, Kai takes them to another cobalt mining planet called Dagus to find the legendary swordswoman, Nemesis. However, she must first save a child from a humanoid spider creature known as Harmata, who seeks revenge on humans for the death of her own children. Harmata rejects negotiations and attacks, leaving Nemesis no choice but to engage in battle. She cuts off one of Harmata's legs, forcing her to drop the child. Gunnar rushes to save the little girl, but Harmata tries to kill him. Nemesis stabs Harmata to divert her attention and then unleashes the power of her swords. As Harmata screams and continues to attack, Nemesis slides underneath and slices through her body. Harmata then grasps Nemesis's neck, but Nemesis manages to kill her by impaling her body with her dual swords. After Nemesis joins the group and they take off again, Cora reveals to Gunnar that she had once been part of the Royal Guard, assigned to protect Princess Issa, who had the unique power of reviving beings. Cora still feels guilt over what happened to Issa and her parents. They arrive on the planet Pollux and head to the gladiatorial arena, where Cora finds the legendary General Titus appearing drunk and sleeping on the streets. After they take him to get cleaned up, he refuses to join them, still ashamed of his past and feeling guilty for causing the death of his soldiers. However, Cora convinces him to fight back so he can seek his revenge. Meanwhile, the captured rebel contact is taken to Noble, who promises to let him go if he provides information. The man reveals that the Blood Axe rebels are protected by King Levitica in Sharan. Noble then kills him. At the same time, Cora's team arrives in Sharan and meets with King Levitica, who arranges a meeting with the Blood Axe rebels. Shortly after, Devra and her brother Darian arrive with their rebel army. Cora explains their purpose, but Devra refuses, believing it to be suicidal. Cora emphasizes that their people have always provided food for them, so the least they can do is defend them. Darian then agrees to help and calls for volunteers from his army. Milius is the first to step forward, followed by a few others. After they take off, Kai expresses his willingness to fight alongside them. However, he mentions he needs to deliver some cargo first. Cora agrees to make one last stop before heading home. Not long after Cora and her group leave, Noble and his troops arrive at Sharan and kill Levitica. Noble then orders his flagship, the King's Gaze, to destroy the place, and he receives a message revealing the location of the rebels. As Cora's group arrives at Gondaval, a trading depot, they help Kai unload the crates. Cora notices Kai talking to a hawkshaw and senses something is wrong. Suddenly, they are ambushed, and the King's Gaze appears, destroying most of Darian's ships. The crates open, revealing devices that capture most of the team members. It turns out that Kai was planning to collect bounties on Cora and the others, knowing Cora's true identity all along. He was using her to gather all the wanted warriors for a big payoff. Noble arrives and reveals that Tarek is a prince, and Nemesis killed Imperium soldiers to avenge her children. Noble then takes Korra's gun, while Kai threatens Gunnar to shoot Korra. However, Gunnar tricks Kai and frees Korra, shooting Kai instead. Korra immediately disarms the nearby soldier and opens fire as she engages in the shootout. She hits a crate, causing an explosion. Gunnar frees the others, and they join the fight. Darian orders his pilots to attack with their ships, and Noble orders the King's Gaze to destroy them all. Enraged, Darian rushes toward the King's Gaze and jumps onto it, stabbing through the glass and killing the pilot. However, he is shot by the pilot in the process and dies. As his arm falls onto the controls, it causes the big ship to crash into the port, destroying it. Korra rushes through the bridge, shooting her way to Noble. In the chaos, Noble falls onto a small platform, where Korra shows up behind him. They engage in fierce hand-to-hand combat, exchanging blows back and forth. Noble punches Korra off the platform, but she manages to grab onto a rope just in time. As Noble cuts the rope, she holds on with one hand and swings the rope, lassoing it around Noble's ankle and pulling him down. She then climbs back up and continues to fight. Korra breaks Noble's cane and stabs his leg with the piece. She overpowers him and breaks his arms, leaving him defenseless. Finally, she uses his own cane to stab him before knocking out his teeth, causing him to fall off the ledge. Afterward, Korra and the surviving rebels return to Velt, where Jimmy watches them from a distance while wearing his antler's crown. Sometime later, Noble's body is discovered by the Imperium, and they proceed to open the back of his head to connect him to the Neuralink. His consciousness is then sent to meet with Belisarius, who scolds him for his failure and gives him one last chance to capture Korra alive so he can execute her himself. Belisarius hits the ice ground with his cane to send Noble's consciousness back to his body. However, Noble still shows no signs of life. They power up with the Imperium's advanced technology, which ultimately resuscitates him.
Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Thanks for watching. Be sure to check out our channel for more videos.